Welcome to the lecture series on computer organization. Today we will discuss about virtual memory concepts. Generally, in computer system, whenever we say the main memory means, it refers to main memory. Whenever we say memory means, it refers to main memory. The throughput, it depends upon the size of the main memory. So if you increase the size of main memory, then it is possible to increase the throughput, and also you can improve the throughput execution time also. One way for doing this is introducing the virtual memory concepts. This virtual memory concept, it gives the illusion for the user that we are having more memory than the actual memory available in main memory. That means, say for example, if the virtual address is 20 bits and the physical address is 15 bits, means in physical address we are having only 2 power 15 address locations, whereas in virtual address you can access up to 2 power 20 locations. So it gives the illusion to the user that we are having so much address space. In that address space, you can fit so many number of programs you can execute. Let us see how it is possible. So virtually, you will have much more space than the physical space. So in this case, and the CPU generates the virtual address. Whereas in the previous lectures, we discussed that CPU always generates main memory address. So when you are going for virtual memory concepts, when you are going to implement this virtual memory concept in the design of computer, definitely the CPU always generates that. It will generates virtual address. The virtual address is always larger than the physical address. So when CPU generates virtual address, here in this case it is 20 bits. First, you build one memory mapping table. With the help of memory mapping table, you will identify the actual 15-bit address. So, with the help of memory mapping table here, you will convert the 20-bit address into 15-bit address. With the help of 15-bit address, you can access the data in the memory location. Once you identify that data in the main memory, you can transfer it to the CPU with the help of intermediate registers. So these are all intermediate register: memory table buffer register, main memory buffer register. Ultimately, the data should be sent to the CPU. This is a block diagram for this. CPU generates virtual address and it is mapped to 15-bit address with the help of main memory table. That address is temporarily stored in the buffer register. From there, you perform the read operation for main memory, and then the data here, this is the main memory, this is also buffer register, address register. With the help of address register, you will access the data, and the data is stored in the main memory buffer register. From this buffer register, you will transfer to the CPU. Now let us see how it is possible. So here there is one terminology, blocks pages. Here we will divide the memory space into blocks, main memory space into blocks. That means the main memory is divided into fixed size blocks, and the address space is divided into pages, page 0, page 1, page 2, page 3. So you see this from this diagram. So once CPU generates this virtual address, the virtual address consists of page number and the index number. So like this, with the help of memory mapping table, here we will call it as paging table. This 101 is separated and it is mapped with the mapping table. If you see this, 101 is here, it is mapped here. And here you can see this, it represents 1. That means that instruction is present in main memory. So corresponding to 101, what is the data available in the mapping table? 01. That 01 is appended to the left hand side of the index address. So instead of 101, you will substitute 01 because of this mapping table. So here, if you see this, the 13-bit address is converted. This is your 13-bit address. It is converted into 12-bit address. Here, this is for example sake, how a 13-bit virtual address is converted into 12-bit physical address. So once you append the data from the mapping table, you can access directly the main memory and you get the data or instruction. I hope this clears. Here the logic is very simple thing. The address space is divided into pages and memory space divided into blocks. Now how it is implemented, how this mapping table is implemented. Generally, if you, as it is, if you do means, you will contain more number of empty blocks. Why? Because the main memory size is small, whereas virtual address is somewhat large. So you will find more number of empty blocks in the paging table. So you better use associative memory for this paging table. So if you use associative memory, you can compare the page number directly with the content present in the associative memory. Correspondingly, you can retrieve the block number. Block number means this is the actual physical address of the main memory. So here 101, it is mapped with the third row in the in this associative memory. So corresponding is third row, 01 is the data you have to substitute in the left hand side of the line number. So you will append, and you in this way you will convert into virtual address into mapping table. You can use associative memory for paging table. Now we'll discuss about page replacement policy. Here you need to understand that in page replacement policy, sometimes this is your main memory. You are having blocks, and this blocks is occupied with pages, page 0, page 1, page 2. If the CPU wants new instruction corresponding to new page, or if it requires new page, then it will access the main memory. If the page is not found, we will call it as a page fault. When page fault occurs, immediately one of the page in the main memory has to be selected. It has to be thrown into secondary memory, that is disk. You have to throw into this. So this is called page replacement policy. For page replacement policy, you will use different algorithms. First one is least recently used. That means you will throw the page which is not used recently. Throw the page which is not recently used. Let us suppose your CPU requests the page number 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 1, 2, something like this. If this is your memory having only 3 blocks, so since CPU requires 5th page is brought into this memory. So next time instant, if CPU requires page 4, it will bring the page 4 into the second block, a third instant. If CPU wants third page, let us suppose these are all page numbers. So immediately CPU brings and stores in the third location. Now it requires page 2. So if you see this, you have accessed this page 3, page 4 recently at second instant, third instant. This is the page which you have not used recently. So you need to select the page 5 and you have to throw it, and immediately you bring page 2 in this location. Now the CPU is asking page number 1. Again, it is not present in our main memory. So for CPU, 2 and 3, they are the recently used. So this is the one that you have to replace. 2, 1, 3. In the next time instant, CPU is asking 1. So CPU, since page 1 is already present in memory, it is accessed immediately. So 2 is also, page number is present in this main memory. So it will be accessed. So now these two are recently accessed. So in this way, the pages are selected and they are swapped with secondary memory, that is a disk. Now there are another set of algorithms which follow the first in, first out policy. That means the page which came earlier, that will be swapped onto the disk. First in, first out policy. So these are the general two strategies. For this also you can write all these things. I hope it is clear. The same thing is written here. So for this structure also, you have to go for page table. Generally, this page table is made up of associative memory, and then this is your physical memory, and this is your disk, secondary storage. Whenever this field contains valid bit, then only you will think that the page is available in physical memory, main memory. Or you can say that if this tag is contains valid, means this field contains actual address. If this field contains invalid bit, means this address is non-valid. So by using page replacement algorithm, you select a particular page and you swap out. And similarly, you bring the new page onto that location, and immediately you will update the address in the paging table. Now, sometimes the page, you know, the page when you are swapping out, it will be immediately updated. After swapping out, it will be updated in the secondary memory. You should understand. Say, for example, if the page is not changed by the CPU, is not modified by the CPU during swapping, you need not perform swapping. Simply, you can delete the page. That is one advantage. Now comes another type of management technique called segmentation. This segmentation technique is introduced for the benefit of users, because users generally group the instructions logically. They will perform the grouping as per the functionality. So the set of logically related instructions, we'll call it as a segments. Generally, these segments it may be a routine, subroutines, or your main program, or a stack also. So if you are having a group of logically related instructions, we will call it as segments. Generally, we will write the programs in that way only. So in that way, if you divide the memory in terms of segment, then it will have certain meaningful information. When you divide the memory in terms of pages, sometimes the logically related instructions may be present in different pages. In such a case, you need to perform two times the swapping operation. So it becomes very difficult. So in order to solve that problem, this segmentation is segmentation concept is introduced. So that means when you group the instructions logically from user point of view, because the users execute the programs logically, so you bring the instructions as a whole. In that case, you can avoid the breaking of programs into multiple pages. So you can see this from this example. User program is a set of different logically related instructions, segments only. This is segments. So now, instead of dividing the programs into pages, we'll divide into segments. Now this time, the CPU generates the segment address. Virtual address consists of segment number and the index number. Segment number and index number. So now instead of paging table, we will have the segment table. In this segment table, you will have two fields, limit and base. So this limit, so whatever the CPU generates the index address, it will check with the limit. If it is within the limit, then you will add this D to the base address available in the segmentation table. That means the base address plus the index address will give you the actual physical address. You can see this. Here in this segmentation type of memory, the CPU generates the segment number and index number. With the help of segment number, you will find the base address. This base address will be added to the index address to get the actual physical address in the memory. So here also we will use segmentation table. Just like paging table, here we will use segmentation table. So now you can see one example. Let us suppose In this user program, we are having 5 segments, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Each segment is having the size. Okay? Size. Say, for example, for segment 0, the size is 1000. That is written as 1000. For segment 3, what is the size? The size is ranges from 3200 to 4300. That means 1100. The size of segment 3 is 1100. So that is written in the limit field. Similarly, for segment 1, it is 400. For segment 2, it is 400. For segment 4, it is 1000. So all the sizes of the segment address is written in the limit address. And the starting address of each segment is written in the base field of the segment table. You can clearly see segment 0 starts from 1400. So we are writing in the base address. Segment 4 starts from 4700. So once you updated the segment table, when the CPU generates segment number and its index number with the help of segmentation table, it will easily identify a particular instruction in a particular segment. You can see this. Okay. Now sometimes different programs can share same libraries or same segments. In such a case, how it is possible? For each user, separate segment tables are maintained because main memory is common between two users. So you can see this. The limit value and base value of segment 0 is common. If you see that this is user 1, this is user 2. Segment 0 is editor, segment 0 is editor. So it is stored in between 43062 to 68348. And the base and the limit value is updated in each segmentation table. In this way, you can share the segment also between different users or different programs. That is the advantage we are having, because users view the program in terms of classes or objects or functions. You can view the segments as functions also. Now, if you use only the segments, the main problem is you may have loss in space. That means something like this. Say, for example, at first time instant, let us suppose this is a main memory. If your main memory consists of segments S0 of size 1000 from 0 to 1000, from 1000 to 1500 segment 1, and the S2 size is 1700 is the first time instant. Say, for example, if you are having another segment in secondary storage of size, let us suppose you perform two swapping due to replacement algorithm. If you swap S1, you will have empty space, empty, here it is S2, 0 to 1000, 1000 to 500, and then 1700. Now, if you bring say, for example, three segments, let us suppose S4, S3, S4, S5 of each S6 status or S7. Each of segment 100. Then your main memory will be something like this. Here it is S0. Now this is S3. This is S4. If you bring S3, S4, S5, S6 into the main memory, the situation will be something like this. After bringing new segments S3, S4, S5 into the main memory, the scenario will be something like this. Each segment is having the size of S3, S4, S5, S6, S7. All segments are having 100 units, let us suppose. If that is the case, say for example, there is another scenario. After some time, if you remove S3, if you remove S3, S5, and S2, let us see the scenario for this. Here it is S0. Just remove S3. So that means you will have empty block. S5 is there. S6 is also there. So instead of S5, you remove S6. It is better. You remove S6. That means the space in this, it will be empty. I think I forgot S4. Let us suppose S4 is also removed. So here 1300. S6 is also removed. 1500, and S2 is also removed. So if you see from this diagram, total free space, how much free space is available? This shaded region, this is 200, and here 100 plus 200. 200 plus 100 plus 200. So therefore, 500 locations are there, but all are located. These locations are are there in different positions of the main memory. This free space is available in different. Say for example, if CPU wants to swap a segment of S8 of size 500, then what is the situation? So this is the main problem. This is the main problem in disadvantage in segmentation. This is the problem. Even though you can bring S8 because of free space available, 500 locations, you cannot bring because the free space is not available continuously. It is available in different locations of the main memory. So this is called as external fragmentation. One solution is to move the segments in any direction, either top-wise or bottom-wise. So, another solution is to divide the segments into pages. To solve this problem, fragmentation problem, divide the segments into pages. And then you start executing. So now, if you divide the segment into pages, say for example, S8, and it is of size 500. If you divide the segments into pages, now you don't need to store all the pages in one location. Say for example, in this case, S8, you can divide the S8 segment into P0, P1, P2 respectively. P0, the size is 200, P1 size is 100, P2 size is 200. Now you store these pages P0, P1, P2 of S8 segment into the freely available space in the memory. That means you can store here P0 of S8, you store here P1 of page 1 of S8, P2 of S8. So that is a specialty. How do we solve a particular problem in this fragmentation? So that means here we are incorporating the segmentation technique. Segmentation technique with paging. So for running a program, for executing a program, you don't need all the pages in the main memory. Even if some pages are there, the CPU starts executing. Whenever there is a free space, then you can swap those pages into the memory and you can start executing. If there is no free space available, simply you can swap the old pages of old segments into the main memory, and then you can bring the new pages of new segments into the main memory, and you start executing. See, when you are doing or swapping all these paging pages and segmentation, you have to update the both segmentation table as well as paging table. Because without segmentation table and paging segmentation table and paging table, it is not possible for you to find out the actual physical address. Paging table. So this is a block diagram for this, how a logical address is divided into actual physical address. Here logical address is divided into three parts: segment, segment number, page number, and the word. Here it represents the index number. So segment number, with the help of segmentation table, with the help of segmentation table, you will find the actual page number. With this page number, with the help of paging table, you calculate the actual physical address. So it is a two-stage process. If you are going by simply segmentation technique or single paging technique, only one table is necessary. Now we are using segmented page table to reduce that external fragmentation problem. So now we'll see one example. Let us suppose the virtual address is 20 bits, 4 bits for segmentation, 8 bits for page and the word or instruction, 8 bit. Now let us see how it is converted into this actual physical address. So in this example, we have taken that physical address is also same as logical address, but in general, it is not like that. Let us draw the mapping. So here, this is your logical address. The segment number is 6, and the page number is 02, and the index number is 78. So if you see this, 6, it refers to the segmentation number. So you have to access the segmentation table. In the segmentation table, you are having the 35 data. This data, it refers to the base address of the segment. So this base address you have to add with page address. So 35 plus 02, you will get 37. So in the page table, you have to go for 37 location. In the 37 location, you have to go for actual physical address. So 019 is the physical address. So 019 is appended with the index location. So actual location is 0197E. So therefore, in this way, you will access the location in the physical memory. You have to locate in the physical memory. You should understand. So the concept is very simple thing. The segment field, page field, and the index field all are separated. The segment field, with the help of segmentation table, you will find the base address. Here it is 35. It is added with 02 page field to get actual page table address. So 35 plus 02 is 37. In this page table, you will get actual physical address 019 together with base address, index address, sorry, 01970. So this is actual physical address. So in this way, you compute by traversing segmentation and page table to get actual physical address. Or you can use direct associative memory. Whenever 602 appears, the block number is 019. So with the help of a content addressable memory, that is associative memory, you can also convert, you can also use it. This is a simple technique. Or you can also compute like this, just how we have computed. So I hope it is clear. It's a very simple operation. So by this, we have completed the different memory management techniques. So we are studying as a part of CVO. Why? Because even though these are all operating system related concepts, you need to incorporate the hardware flexibility. In order to support these OS concepts, you need physical hardware also. For that reason, we are studying in CVO. So I hope it clears all these things. So with this, we completed memory management techniques.